الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق الأجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء حبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما مولانا صاحب الأمر والزمان روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters, سلام عليكم ورحمة الله وأعظم الله أجورنا وأجوركم. May Allah سبحانه وتعالى reward you and increase for us our grief over the tragedies of Ahlul Bayt. And truly, these days of Shahr al-Safar are days of great grief for the Shias of Ahlul Bayt. These are the days in which you find the Shia world commemorating the martyrdom of the first grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Imam Hassan ibn Ali al-Mujtaba salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, and the martyrdom of the daughter of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam by the name of Sayyida Ruqayya alayha salam, this three-year-old daughter who was martyred in the prison of Sham when the Ahlul Bayt were taken as hostages and as prisoners and as slaves from Karbala to Kufa and Kufa to Sham. For I extend my condolences to you, brothers and sisters, and first and foremost, we extend our condolences to the master of our time, Imam Sahib al-Amri wa-Zaman. Ahibai, I am Sheikh Muhammad Abbas Panju, and with you, we are here on the live Facebook show. And as we have been doing over the last couple of weeks, we have been analyzing and scrutinizing some of the hadith that are mentioned within the classical text known as Kamilu Ziyarat, authored by Ibn Qawlawai Rahmatullah Alayh. And to continue with the ahadith that we have been analyzing in regards to the importance, the divinity and the adama that is attached to the ziyara and the pilgrimage of Imam al-Hussein. Before we go into this bath or continue in this discussion, one thing that I would like to add in regards to the days that we are currently living, that are marked by, as we said in the beginning, the istishhad and the martyrdom of Sayyida Ruqayya alayha salam. Ahibai, it is absolutely important for us within the Shia world to revive in particular the madlumiyya, the oppression and the martyrdom of the daughter of Imam al-Hussein by the name of Sayyida Ruqayya, for a number of reasons. The first thing is that, or the first point of importance, is that you find that when we emphasize on the tragedy and the oppression of Sayyida Ruqayya, a three-year-old daughter, you find that this is a form of oppression that each and every human being has the ability to comprehend and to resonate with this. In that, regardless of which faith you are, regardless of which sect you are, all human beings, you can say, mankind, are agreed upon the fact that oppression on children, slavery of children, imprisonment of children, and using them as prisoners of war or using them as trophies within war is something that is detestable, is a crime against humanity that each and every person comprehends. And it is important for us over here to emphasize on the oppression that was carried out on Sayyida Ruqayya by those forces, the forces of Bani Umayya, that were acting in the name of Islam. Yes, in the Islam of Bani Umayya, imprisonment of women and imprisonment of children and persecution of children is part of religion. It's a part of Islam. But which Islam? Not the Islam of Ahlul Bayt, not the Islam of Rasulullah, the Islam of Bani Saqifa and the Islam of Bani Umayya. So this is number one. Number two, Ahibai, you find that Ajib Jiddan, is extremely surprising that in this day, in this age, we have certain people who claim to be Shia, certain people, certain scholars who claim to be from the teachings or to be from the followers of the teachings of Ahlul Bayt, yet they come forward on our pulpits through their writings and they try and put shak. They try and they plant doubts in regards to not only the oppression that happened on Sayyidah Ruqayya, but they come and they plant doubts over the existence of Sayyidah Ruqayya alayha salam. Where now we have certain individuals, we have scholars, and you have a wave of movement which is aimed at reducing and diluting the tragedy of Karbala in its entirety by negating the existence of individuals, divine individuals, such as Sayyidah Ruqayya. For tonight's show, much as our emphasis is on the book Kamilu Ziyarat, but it is also important for us on these days of Muharram, on these days of Imam al-Husayn, and these days of Arba'een, that we are cognizant of the attack that is happening on Shiaism from within so-called Shia, particularly the issue of Sayyidah Ruqayya. And inshallah, we shall have a discussion, or we shall have a program in where we are historically able to establish the existence of Sayyidah Ruqayya, excuse me, as one of the daughters of Imam al-Husayn, in which there is absolutely no shak. But what I want to say for tonight is that when it comes to the issue of Sayyidah Ruqayya, these scholars, these so-called intellectuals, these so-called thinkers, these so-called reformists, who come and claim that the entire incident of Sayyidah Ruqayya is a fabrication. I'm talking about those people who claim to be Shia. If you think that Sayyidah Ruqayya as an individual is a fabrication and she had no existence, then I dare and I challenge such people. If this is the case, then that means that her haram, her shrine in Damascus, is also a fabrication, because it has been made a mazar, it has been made a place of ziyara, where thousands, if not over the years, millions of people have gone to the grave of Sayyidah Ruqayya and hold commemoration ceremonies there and pray there and have built a masjid there and do tawassul and perform wasila at the grave. So according to these people, they perform wasila and they do tawassul at the gravesite of an individual that was a historical fabrication, in which case that shrine and that haram has absolute no importance. If this is the case, then I challenge and I dare these people who question the existence of Sayyidah Ruqayya, go up and demolish that grave of Sayyidah Ruqayya. This grave that is attributed to Sayyidah Ruqayya, attributed to an individual who you think is a fabrication, yalla, go and destroy the shrine. In fact, they need to put hands together with the Salafis, they need to put their hands together with the Wahhabi, they need to put their hands together with the Daesh. Let them go and let them destroy the shrine of Sayyidah Ruqayya. Why? It doesn't matter to you, because at the end of the day, this is the grave of an individual that didn't even exist in history. Yalla, give a statement, sit on the manabir and go and encourage and congratulate Daesh and other people like Daesh to go and destroy the shrine of Sayyidah Ruqayya. What does it matter to you? It's a shrine, it's a gravesite of a person who doesn't exist. They will be doing the Shias a big favor by getting rid of a mazar that belongs to a fabricated person. Ahibai, it's through arguments like these, through simple logic like these, that we are able to discover the dalala, the deviation of individuals such as these who want to negate the existence of Sayyidah Ruqayya and as a result attack the tragedies of Imam al-Husayn. They want to dilute the intensity and they want to dilute the gravity of the war crimes that were performed inside of Ashura. For what? For political reasons? For what? For acceptability? For what? To present a version of tashayyu that is acceptable to others? By Allah, with what face will you stand in front of Sayyidah Shuhada on the day of judgment? For the dunya, for the fact that your intellect is not able to process information, you go and you wipe out an entire part of history. What will they say to Sayyida Ruqayyah herself on the day of judgment when she stands in front of Allah Azza wa Jal with her bruised and her battered body, a body filled with wounds and marks from the lashes and the whips? She comes and she says, Ya Allah, I was oppressed by Bani Ubayyah. With what face will you stand in front of Sayyida Ruqayyah on that day? We don't even want to go into the establishing the historical proof. But ya ikhwani, ahibba'i, we have to be very careful of these attacks that come by way of shukuk in regards to the events of Karbala, the commemoration of Karbala, and Sayyida Ruqayyah in particular. I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal that each and every one of us have the tawfiq of attending the majalis of Sayyida Ruqayyah, of arranging majalis for Sayyida Ruqayyah, arranging and participating in azadari, in the azah for Sayyida Ruqayyah. And may Allah Azza wa Jal give us the opportunity to perform the ziyarah of Sayyida Ruqayyah in the dunya and gain her shafa'ah in the akhirah, insha'Allah. Ahibba'i, coming to our discussion for tonight in regards to continuation of the hadith of ziyarat from this great book. And it's the book which we have been using for the last couple of weeks. It's a book which is also translated, a book which is widely available within the markets, a classical text, one of the most important books, not only in regards to hadith of the thawab and the importance and the secrets of the ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn in particular and Ahlul Bayt in general, but this is a book which is a book istidlali. It's a book from a fiqhi perspective that is used by the ulama in order to extract a hukum shar'i in regards to the vastness of the commemorating rites and rituals, the rites used to commemorate the dhikr of Imam al-Husayn. Kamilu Ziyarat, authored by Ibn Kawlaway, Rahmatullah Alayh. This book is also available in English. The hadith that we're analyzing for today in regards to the importance of the ziyarah of Arba'een. And ya subhanallah, we are at the doorstep of the ziyarah of Arba'een, this first week of Shahru Safar. Alhamdulillah wa shukr. People in the thousands have come out walking from the city of Basra and from other places in and around Iraq to come and embark upon this great journey of pledging allegiance to Imam al-Husayn through the Ziyarah Arba'iniyya, which is one of the greatest signs of strength, display of strength, one of the greatest tokens, the greatest events that display the strength of the Shia is the Ziyarah Arba'iniyya. And hence when you find the people who attack the ziyarah of Arba'een, in essence are attacking or are encompassed by a sort of fear from the demonstration of the power of Tashayyu and the power of the Shias when it comes to demonstrating their loyalty to Ahlul Bayt. Fa, alhamdulillah wa shukar, haniyan, congratulations to all those millions of zawar who are making ways towards Karbala, who are planning to go to Karbala and Siddiq, subhanallah. These are times of alhamdulillah wa shukar, great ni'mah of Allah Azza wa Jal. Whichever Shia community you go to, you will find that there are groups of men and groups of women and groups of children here and there talking about the Ziyarah Arba'een, planning their Ziyarah Arba'een. One is looking for a ticket, one is looking for an accommodation, one is planning out his itinerary, one is planning out what he's going to do, where he's going to go, how long they are going to stay for. Those who are not able to go are asking each other for dua and so on so forth. And the entire Shia community is united around Imam al-Husayn. There is only one thing within the mind of the lovers of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, and that is this Ziyarah Arba'iniyya. Allahu Akbar. It's a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fa, in regards to this Ziyarah, Hadith al-Sharif, you notice that this is in Al-Bab al-Thaminu wa-Sab'un, chapter 78. And the title of this chapter is Fi Man Taraka Ziyarat al-Husayn, the one who abandons or the one who leaves out the ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn. Tayyib, What do the imams have to talk, or what do the imams have to say about those individuals who, by purpose, on purpose, intentionally downplay or do not go for ziyarah? Those people who, despite having the ability, despite having the capacity, they decide not to go for ziyarah. They leave the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein. What do the imams have to say about this? And ba'd, there is a istithna, those group of people who are not able to go, who have legit concerns. And last week we talked about the importance of even taking the fada'il and the importance and the acceptability, the permissibility, and in fact the recommendation of even taking loans to go for the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein. To go undergo through strain, whether it is financial or otherwise, for the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein. This is all counted as a jihad in the way of Imam al-Hussein. But in either case, people have exemptions. Person sincerely is not able to make it for the ziyarah for any reason. They are istithna, yeah, mustathna. They are exempted from this. This hadith is talking about individuals who are able to go for the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein. They have the ability, they have absolutely no excuse. And we have to be truthful to ourselves in that, what is an excuse and what is not an excuse. But those people who do not have an excuse, they could go to Karbala, they could go to visit Imam Hussein, but they don't go. They abandon the ziyarah, they delay the ziyarah unnecessarily. Look at what the Imam says. This is, under this chapter, this is the third narration, hadith number three, which is narrated on authority of عن أبي عبد الله يعني إمام الصادق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه قال من لم يأتي قبر الحسين عليه السلام وهو يزعم أنه لنا شيعة حتى يموت فليس هو لنا بالشيعة. الله أكبر. حديث makes your hair stand. He says, the person who claims that he is from our Shia, yani a person who claims that he is from our Shia, and does not go to the grave of Imam al-Hussein, does not perform the ziyarah, does not perform the visitation of Imam al-Hussein, hatta yamut, and in the process he dies. And this can mean a number of things. Person keeps delaying the ziyarah, keeps delaying the ziyarah, next year, next month, next week. Baba, we don't know when death is going to come to us. You don't know when Malakul Maut is going to come and knock on your door. What does the hadith say? The person who dies, having not performed the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein, neglecting the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein, and he claims to be from our Shia, the Imam says, فَلَيْسَ هُوَ لَنَا بِشِيعَ. The Imam says, according to us, we don't consider him to be our Shia. And look at this, even more, and I wrap up before we go for a break. The last statement for this. وَإِنْ كَانَ مِنْ أَحْلِ الْجَنَّةِ فَهُوَ مِنْ ذِيفَانِ أَحْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. And even if he enters into Jannah, he is as if he is from the guests or the stranger in Jannah. Meaning that a person who purposely, intentionally, willfully neglects and abandons the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein, even if he makes it into Jannah, even if he makes it into paradise, he will make it into paradise as feeling as a guest or feeling as a stranger. فأحبائي, stamp your position in Jannah, stamp your residency in Jannah through the visitation of Imam al-Hussein. And inshallah, we will continue with you with the rest of the ahadith from Kamilu Ziyarat after this short break. Salaamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Salaam alaikum wa rahmatullah. Respected brothers and sisters, dear viewers of Imam Al-Hussein TV, I'd like to welcome you back to the second segment of our show, the Live Facebook show, where we are discussing hadith selected from the book Kamil al-Ziyarat, authored by the grand scholar and pioneer of this faith, Sheikh Ibn Qawlawayh al-Qummi, rahmatullah alayh, who, by the way, is buried right next to Sheikh Mufid in Qadhmain in the Haram al-Sharif of Imam al-Kadhim and Imam al-Jawad, alayhim as-salam. Fa inshallah entum zawar. When you go, or if you do get the opportunity to perform the ziyarah of the Blessed Imamain in Qadhimain, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Qadhim wa Imam Muhammad ibn Ali al-Jawad, I would ask you that when you perform the ziyarah of these two imams, take some time out from your ziyarah to actually stand by the grave of Ibn Qawlawayh and to stand by the grave of Sheikh Mufid and recite for them Suratul Fatiha, if not Suratul Yasin, and thank them and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for blessing us with scholars, the likes of Ibn Qawlawayh al-Qummi and the likes of Sheikh al-Mufid rahmatullah alayhima, for the great services that they have done towards tashayyuh, the great writings that they have left behind and have protected the legacy of this deen through these writings. They have a right upon us, and not only are we to benefit from their books and their writings, but a part and a token of our appreciation, a demonstration of our appreciation and gratitude, shukr, is that we at least recite Suratul Fatiha at their graves. And having said this, Ahibai, it is the period of Arba'een and the period of Ziyarah, and the joy and the atmosphere is of the Ziyarah. But let me mention for you a couple of things as well. As a side note before we go on to the hadith. Ahibai, Baghdad in itself is a place in which there are numerous areas of Ziyarah. And if I'm not mistaken, there have been a couple of shows on Imam Al-Hussein TV as well in regards to the different mazarat that there are inside of Iraq, inside of Qadhmain and Baghdad as well, in the outskirts of Baghdad. And in my humble opinion, Zawar should make a constant effort. They should make an active effort to go and visit these other places, mazarat, that are in and around Qadhmain. So for example, from the places of Ziyarah that you have in and around Qadhmain, within the city of Baghdad, we have got number one, the grave of Sheikh Al-Kulayni, rahmatullah alayh, the author of the book Kitabul Kafi. He has got a mazar. There is a grave for his inside, which can be visited for us to recite Suratul Fatiha and to pay tribute to one of the greatest scholars of Tashayyu. Yani, the book Kitabul Kafi is unparalleled. And until today, Marja Taqlid cannot become a Marja Taqlid until and unless he has mastered the book of Al-Kafi, the first book of its kind to be ever authored. For the grave of Sheikh Al-Kulayni rahmatullah alayh is also in Baghdad. Within Baghdad, for example, we have the gravesites of the four Nawab, the four special appointed representatives of Imam Sahib Al-Amri Waz-Zaman during the time of Ghaybat al-Sughra. You have their gravesites within the local markets inside of Baghdad, an area which is absolutely safe and a place in which there is a mazar, there is a dari built around it where we could go and recite our two rak'ah salat many times during the year, particularly on 15th of Sha'ban. We write the arida, we write the letter to Imam al-Hujjah, and you find that this letter, ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif, this letter is authored by or sent using the name of his wakil, Hussein ibn Ruh al-Nawbakhti. The grave of Hussein ibn Ruh al-Nawbakhti is in Baghdad. The person goes and builds his relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal, builds his relationship with Ahlul Bayt, builds his relationship with Imam al-Hujjah by having tawassul or mediating, seeking the wasila of Imam al-Hujjah through his nawab. These were the people who were the representatives, they were the wasila and the connection between the people and the Imam Zaman of our time. Therefore, we go and we pay tribute to them. And these are all local mazarat in and around the Haram of Imam Al-Kadhim and Imam Al-Jawad. If you venture a little bit further out from Kathmain, you are also able to go to Madain, for example. Within the locality of Madain, you have the grave of Salman al-Muhammadi, Mazar, Haram that is in the process of construction, and the Dhari that is found within this. You have the gravesite of Salman al-Muhammadi. This Salman who Rasulullah would say, Salman minna Ahlul Bayt. This Salman who was the most loyal companion of Amirul Mu'mineen. This Salman who stood at the forefront when it came to the time of Saqifa and did not abandon Amirul Mu'mineen, excuse me, for the blink of an eye. This Salman through whom karamat and fada'il are narrated. Allah. So these are places that revive the history. These are places that connect our irtibat, that strengthen our irtibat, our connection with Ahlul Bayt. And these are places of ziyara that we should not neglect. Within the same area is the grave of Hudhaifa, for example. Again, another companion of Rasulullah and the companion of Amirul Mu'mineen. Hudhaifa was one of those companions who carried the secrets of Rasulullah, and in particular the secrets of those, the identity of those munafiqeen who attempted to assassinate Rasulullah during his lifetime. Hudhaifa saw them with his eyes, and Hudhaifa concealed their identity upon the command of Rasulullah. But the people were able to figure out who those munafiqeen were, because after the martyrdom of Rasulullah, Hudhaifa would not recite the Salatul Mayyit upon those munafiqeen whose identities were concealed, but he knew them, who were implicated in the attempted assassination of Rasulullah. So the people would say, we figured out eventually who tried to assassinate the Holy Prophet by observing Hudhaifa. If he attended the Salatul Mayyit or Salatul Janazah of any one of the companions, we know they are not from the Munafiqeen. And those, the ones Hudhaifa didn't attend, we knew, Hatman, there is. They are from the hypocrites. And there's an entire chapter in the Quran that is the chapter of the hypocrites. Ahibai, the reason that I say this to you is because Iraq is the land of Ahlul Bayt. Iraq is the land of history. Iraq is the land of the culture and heritage of Ahlul Bayt and Islam. And it is important that we are connected with our history in order to strengthen our faith. Having said this, Ahibai, we go on to the next hadith in regards to the ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn. And this particular narration is taken from the book Jami' Ahadith al-Shia. And you have this narrated as well in Al-Mustadrak. And yes, you have this narrated in Al-Mustadrak as well. Hadith al-Sharif talks about the relationship of the Malaika with the Zawar of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. And for our beloved viewers, respected viewers who if they were following the series, last week we spoke about how the Malaika and the Anbiya performed the ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn. And we spoke about in particular how Nabi Musa was coming to perform the ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn accompanied by the angels. Having said this, something closer. And this is what ma'rifah is. And this is a part of that ma'rifah which is matloob, which is required when you go for ziyarah. This is why it says that when you perform the ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn with ma'rifah, your rewards increase. Doesn't mean that you don't get any reward if you visit Imam al-Husayn without ma'rifah. Khata kabir, this is a big mistake for somebody to say that, oh, if you didn't have the ma'rifah of Imam al-Husayn, your ziyarah is not accepted, your ziyarah is not worth it, your ziyarah is not rewarded. Who said this? Did any one of the imams say this? Show me a narration. Is there a narration where any one of the imams says that if you visit Imam al-Husayn without ma'rifah, you get punished or your ziyarah is not accepted? La, ahibai, we have to be careful in our speech. Person who has ma'rifah, of course, his rewards for his ziyarah increase. And his benefit from the ziyarah in terms of his spirituality and in terms of the desired result from the ziyarah increases. But people benefit from the ziyarah according to their ma'rifah. However, we cannot say that a person who doesn't have ma'rifah, no, there's no point for him to go for ziyarah. We're not in a position to say that. In any case, The ma'rifah that is matlub, or a path, or a type of a ma'rifah that is matlub, is from understanding the adama of the act in which we are engaged. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give each and every one of us the opportunity to perform the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein in the dunya and seek his intercession in the akhirah. Hadith is sharif in regards to, look at the title of the hadith. إِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ يَسِمُونَ وُجُوهَ زُوَّارِ الْحُسَيْنِ بِمِيسَمْ نُورِ عَرْشِ اللَّهِ The Malaika. The Malaika place a seal or a stamp. Misam, yani like a stamp through which you are able to be recognized, like a seal. فَدَ مَلَائِكَ stamp or place a seal on the faces of the Zuwar of Imam al-Hussein. And this stamp or this seal, what is it made from? This seal is made from the Noor, from the light of the Arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. This is the daraja of the Zawar of Imam al-Hussein. We need to appreciate and understand the value of this ziyarah which we are about to embark upon, insha'Allah. Hadith is sharif in narrated on authority of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam himself. And the hadith is pretty lengthy. So I will read out the part of the hadith that is relevant to us. إن جبرائيل عليه السلام قال له بعد ذكر ما جرى على الحسين عليه السلام في الطف وأنه يدفن ويجعل له رسم قال After جبرائيل عليه السلام narrated to Rasulullah all the atrocities and the crimes that will be carried upon Imam al-Hussein, the manner in which he will be martyred, brutally killed on the plains of Karbala, the manner in which he will be buried, and how his grave will be made into a central location. After all this, he says, وَتَحُفُّهُ مَلَائِكَةٌ Yani the grave of Imam al-Hussein will be flooded by congregations of angels. It will be surrounded by angels in its entirety. مِنْ كُلِّ سَمَاءٍ مِئَةَ أَلْفٍ مَلِكٍ From every strata, from every level of the heavens, there will be 100,000 angels. في كل يوم وليلة, in every morning and every night, ويصلون عليه ويسبحون الله عنده, and they are sending their salutations on Imam al-Hussein, and they are in a constant state of tasbih towards tasbih of Allah Azza wa Jal. Yes, ba'ad. What else do they do? So they send salams on Imam al-Hussein. Look at the ibadat of these malaika. Number one, they're sending salutations upon Imam al-Hussein. Number two, they are in a state of tasbih. Number three, glorifying Allah Azza wa Jal. Number three, وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ اللَّهَ لِزُوَّارِهِ Allahu Akbar. They seek forgiveness for the sins of the visitors of Imam al-Hussein. Haniyan lakum. Haniyan, congratulations to all the zuwar of Imam al-Hussein. Congratulations to all those who have the love of Imam al-Hussein. Where? Not because you and I are deserving, but because of our love for Imam al-Hussein and the fact that you go and embark upon a journey to visit Imam al-Hussein for the sake of Imam al-Hussein, out of this grand reward and position of Imam al-Hussein. The Malaika seek forgiveness for us because you came to visit Imam al-Hussein. The Malaika find you deserving to seek forgiveness for you. وَيَكْتُبُونَ أَسْمَاءَ مَنْ يَأْتِ زَائِرًا مِنْ أُمَّتِكَ And there are angels who have scrolls, and they write down and they record the names of every one of the visitors from your ummah that come to Imam al-Husayn mutakarriban ila Allah ta'ala wa ilayka. Yani those zawar who come with the intention. And tab'an over here, do you see, find that we are getting an indication of the niyyah of the intention, the niyyah or the intention of the ziyara to seek proximity towards Allah. Not only that, wa ilayka, to seek proximity towards Rasulullah through the ziyara. Their names are written down on this scroll list of the zawar, of the malaika, sorry. وَأَسْمَاءَ آبَائِهِمْ وَأَشَائِرِهِمْ وَبُلْدَانِهِمْ. Your entire identity is noted and listed in this scroll that is in the hands of the malaika. This registrar, you can say. This register in which the names are written down by the angels. Not only is your name written down, but the name of your fathers and the name of your tribes and the cities from which you have come. Tasjeel, there is a registration. Each and every person coming to Karbala. Ya Zair, have it firmly planted in your mind. You are within the scroll of the Malaika, within the heavens. وَيَسِمُونَ. Look at what the hadith says. Ba'ad, what do the angels do after recording your name in this list? Recording your presence and your attendance in the ziyarah of Imam al-Husayn? وَيَسِمُونَ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ بِمِيسَمْ نُورِ عَرْشِ اللَّهِ. They put a seal. They stamp a seal on the faces of the zawar of Imam al-Husayn. And this stamp is made from the noor of the arsh of Allah Azza wa Jal. From the light of the arsh of Allah Azza wa Jal. What does this stamp say on the forehead or on the faces of the zawar? These are divine stamps. هَذَا زَائِرُ قَبْرِ خَيْرِ الشُّهَدَى وَابْنِ خَيْرِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. This is the visitor of the grave of the best of the shuhada and the son of the best of the anbiya. فَإِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ فَإِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ سَطَعَ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثْرِ ذَلِكَ الْمَيْسَمْ نُورٌ تُغْشَى مِنْهُ الْأَبْصَارِ يَدِلُّ عَلَيْهِمْ وَيُعْرَفُونَ بِهِ. On the day of judgment, as a result of your face being stamped with this divine seal, the seal made from the nur of the arsh of Allah, that you are the zair of Imam al-Husayn. The hadith says, Jibra'il tells Rasulullah, on the day of judgment, when the zair of Imam al-Husayn is raised, this nur, this light will emanate so brightly from the faces of the zuwar of Imam al-Husayn, the people will become blinded due to the radiance that is emanating from the faces of the zuwar of Imam al-Husayn. Allah, Allah, Allah. Ahibba'i, the hadith goes on, and our time is almost, and our time I'm sure is finished. Ya Ahibba'i, do not lose out on this opportunity to gain the highest level of success in the dunya and in the akhirah. You want to be raised on the day of judgment with a radiant face, more radiant than the moon, more light emanating and more beauty emanating than the moon. Then make sure you visit Imam al-Husayn, wa khasatan the ziyara arba'een, and do not miss out on the opportunity for your face to be sealed or to be stamped with this divine nur that emanates from the arsh of Allah Azza wa Jal. I pray to Allah by the Sheikh of Sayyida Ruqayyah alayhi salam, Tifla al-Madhluma, the oppressed daughter of Imam al-Hussein. I pray by her Sheikh to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All our brothers and sisters from the east and the west of the world who are traveling to Karbala for the ziyarah, may they have a safe journey and may they have a prosperous journey. May all their du'as and their hajat be accepted. And I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal by the sake of Sayyida Ruqayyah, mu'mineen and mu'minat who are not able to go for ziyarah this year, Ya Allah, by the Shaykh of Sayyida Ruqayyah, open for all our brothers and sisters those of rizq, khair and barakat, such that they may also get a chance to visit Imam al-Hussein. And Ya Allah, always help us and always bless us, such that so long as we are alive, with every drop of blood in our veins, we uphold the commemoration of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Inshallah, my dear viewers, until our next episode or our next program, fi amanillah, salamun alaykum, ya Ali Madad. Oh.